The anatomy of the female reproductive system. Let's straight away go to define what the anatomy of female reproductive system includes. The female reproductive system includes the ovaries, uterus, fallopian tubes, cervix, vagina, and vulva. Below is an image which is depicting the ovaries, uterus, fallopian tubes, cervix, vagina, and vulva. Let's look at the ovaries. The ovaries are fairly reproductive organs that are responsible for production of eggs or ova and also hormones. Oogenesis is the process of egg cell development within the ovaries. The ovaries also secrete hormones, estrogen and progesterone, which are responsible for regulating the menstrual cycle and also support pregnancy. Below is an image of the ovary. Let's look at the structure of the ovaries, location and size. The ovaries are located within the pelvic cavity. External features, the ovaries are oval-shaped organs that are attached to the uterus by ovarian ligaments. Each ovary contains thousands of tiny structures called follicles. In the previous image, you will see where the ovarian follicles are located. Still in this other image below, you can be able to see the location of the ovaries within the pelvis, and you can be able to see the suspensory ligament of the ovary and the ligament of the ovary. Common functions of the ovaries. The ovaries produce two hormones, estrogen and progesterone. Estrogen is responsible for the development and maintenance of female secondary sexual characteristics, regulation of the menstrual cycle, and also bone health. Some of the female sexual characteristics include the development of the breasts, the hips, increase in weight. Progesterone. The function of progesterone is to prepare the uterus for potential pregnancy and support early pregnancy. Let's look at oogenesis, that is egg cell development. Oogenesis is the process of egg cell development which occurs within the ovaries, and it begins before birth with the formation of primary oocytes. During each menstrual cycle, a small number of primary oocytes develop into secondary oocytes. Let's move on to the Ovarian cycle. The ovarian cycle consists of two phases. We have the follicular phase and the luteal phase. Follicular phase is responsible for follicle development and maturation of the follicles under the influence of follicle-stimulating hormone. Luteal phase. During the luteal phase, the ruptured follicles transforms into the corpus luteum, which produces progesterone. Let's look at the ovarian cycle. Below is an image of the ovarian cycle phases. The image shows the follicular phase, whereby the follicles are growing. Then somewhere the follicle is released, then the luteal phase, the corpus luteum forms, then degenerates. Let's look at ovulation. Ovulation is the release of a mature egg from the ovary. It typically occurs around the middle of the menstrual cycle. But in a cycle of 28 days, the ovulation usually occurs around the 14th day. The seed of luteinizing hormone is the one which is responsible for triggering ovulation. Let's look at the uterus. The uterus is also known as the womb, and it is the organ, and it is a very important organ in the female reproductive system, in that it plays a central role in supporting pregnancy and also childbirth. Below is the image of the uterus. Let's move on to the structure of the uterus. Location and size. The uterus is located within the pelvic cavity, and it is a pear-shaped muscular organ, and it has internal features like the uterine cavity, cervix, and uterine walls. Let's look at the layers of the uterine wall. Endometrium is the innermost layer of the uterus, and it is rich in blood vessels. It undergoes cyclic changes during the menstrual cycle. We have the second layer, which is known as the myometrium. Myometrium is composed of the muscle layer of the uterus, and the muscles are smooth muscles, and the myometrium is responsible for uterine contractions during the time of labor. Then we have the perimetrium. Perimetrium is the outer layer that covers the uterus. The image below depicts the layers of the uterus, that is the endometrium, myometrium, and the perimetrium. Though you will see a lot of other structures that are located on this diagram, but concentrate on the endometrium, myometrium, and perimetrium. Those are the layers we are talking about at the moment. Let's look at the functions of the uterus. One of the functions of the uterus is embryo implantation. The uterus provides a nourishing environment for the fertilized ova to implant and develop. That is in case implantation takes place. Gestation. The uterus expands or grows to accommodate the growing fetus during pregnancy. The other function of the uterus is during labor and childbirth, the strong contractions of the uterus help in delivery of the baby. Let's look at the menstrual cycle and the uterus. The uterus undergoes cyclic changes during the menstrual cycle. In the proliferative phase, the endometrium thickens to prepare for possible pregnancy. Then during the secretory phase, the endometrium becomes highly vascularized and during this time, it is preparing for the embryo to implant in case fertilization occurred. Let's look at the cervix. The cervix is another very important part of the female reproductive system, and it is located at the lower end of the uterus. It serves as a passage for the uterus and the vagina. Let's look at the anatomy of the cervix. Location and structure of the cervix. The cervix is located within the pelvic cavity. External features. The cervix can be felt as a firm structure during a pelvic examination. But also, if you touch the tip of your nose, the consistency, or if you touch the tip of the nose, the consistency of the cervix feels like the tip of the nose. That is when a woman is not pregnant. But if a woman is pregnant, the cervix becomes soft, and you can compare it to the softness that you feel when you touch your mouth, the lips, when you touch the lips of your mouth. Internal structures of the cervix include the cervical canal, cervical opening or os, and also the transformation zone. Below is an image which is showing the endocervical canal, the cervix, the vagina, and the transformation zone. Let's look at the functions of the cervix. One of the first functions of the cervix is a barrier function. The cervix acts as a physical barrier, preventing foreign substances from entering into the uterus. Second function is production of cervical mucus. The cervix produces mucus that changes consistency throughout the menstrual cycle, facilitating sperm to penetrate in fertility. This can easily be noticed. These changes can easily be noticed by the woman if she observes the cervical changes, especially after a period, after the menstrual period. The cervical mucus will not be much. Then, as time goes on, the cervical mucus begins increasing. Then, as as she approaches maybe the 14th day, that is if it's in a 28-day cycle, the cervical mucus becomes very slippery. So that cervical mucus that has become very slippery is the one which facilitates the transportation of the sperm in case a woman meets with a man or plays sexual intercourse with a man. It means that service, the cervical mucus, because it's slippery, it will easily allow the sperm to swim to reach the ovum. But after the 14th day, then the cervical mucus is not very slippery. It's not slippery anymore because ovulation has already taken place. The other function of the cervix is to dilate during childbirth. The cervix undergoes gradual dilatation to allow the passage of baby during labor and also the placenta. Cervical changes throughout the menstrual cycle. The cervix undergoes cyclic changes under the influence of hormonal fluctuations during the menstrual cycle. During ovulation, the cervix becomes softer, higher, and more open to facilitate sperm entry. So that the sperm can be able to swim to the fallopian tubes. Let's look at the fallopian tubes. The fallopian tubes are also known as the uterine tubes or oviducts, and they form very important component of the female reproductive system in that they play a role in the fertilization of the ova and the transportation of the fertilized egg into the uterus. Let's look at the anatomy of the fallopian tubes. Location and structure. The fallopian tubes are located within the pelvic cavity. External features. The fallopian tubes are elongated tubes attached to each side of the uterus. If you look at the image below, it's depicting the fallopian tubes that are located within the pelvic cavity and they lie on both sides of the uterus. Let's look at the functions of the fallopian tubes. One of the functions of the fallopian tube is transportation of eggs. The fallopian tubes capture the released ova from the ovaries and transport them downwards to the uterus where implantation takes place. Fertilization is also another function of the fallopian tube. If the sperm is present in the fallopian tubes, fertilization of the ova can occur within the ampulla. Early development. After fertilization, the fertilized egg or ova undergoes cell division as it is traveling through the fallopian tubes towards the uterus where it will implant. Let's look at the role in reproductive process. Ovulation. The fallopian tubes are also crucial for capturing the release ova during ovulation. Sperm transportation. Sperm can ascend through the cervix, uterus, and into the fallopian tubes to meet the egg. Fertilization and early development. The fallopian tubes provide an optimal environment for fertilization and early embryonic development. Let's look at the vagina. The vagina is a vital organ of the female reproductive system, and it serves multiple functions. One of it is sexual intercourse, childbirth, and menstruation. The vagina is a muscular canal that connects the cervix to the external genitalia. Other books put it that the vagina is a is also a tube-like structure. The image below depicts the vagina. Functions of the vagina. One of the functions of vagina is sexual intercourse. The vagina provides a passageway for the penis during sexual intercourse, facilitating pleasure and also reproduction. Second function, the vagina acts as a birth canal. During childbirth, the baby passes through the vagina, allowing the delivery of the infant and also the placenta. Menstruation. The vagina serves as an outlet for the menstrual blood to leave the body during menstrual cycle. Let's look at vaginal health and pH balance. The vagina has an acidic pH level that helps maintain a healthy environment. And this acidic pH is being provided with the help of the lactobacillus bacilli that stay in the vagina. Vaginal discharge. Normal vaginal discharge helps to cleanse the vagina and maintain its pH balance. Factors affecting vaginal health include hormonal changes, sexual activity, hygiene practices, and certain medical conditions. Let's look at the vulva. The vulva is the external part of the female genitalia, composing of various structures that play important role in the reproduction and sexual function. The vulva includes the external genitalia that is visible on the outside of the body. Location and the external appearance of the vulva. Structures of the vulva includes the mons pubis, which is covered by hair. We have the labia majora, these are larger lips. The labia minora, these are the smaller lips. Then we have the clitoris, the urethral opening, vaginal opening, and the perineum. The image below depicts the various structures that I've just mentioned. Let's look at the functions of the vulva. One of the first functions of the vulva is protection. The vulva acts as a protective barrier for the internal reproductive organs. Second function is a sexual function. The vulva contains highly sensitive structures that contribute to sexual pleasure and orgasm. One of the most sensitive structures is the clitoris. The other function of the vulva is for passage of urine and the menstrual flow, whereby urine passes via the urethra and the menstrual flow passes via the vagina. The vagina includes urethral and vaginal openings that allow for urine and also menstrual blood flow. Let's look at hormonal regulation of the female reproductive system. Thank you. The female reproductive system is regulated by a complex interplay of hormones that control various processes. Hormones play a crucial role in the menstrual cycle, ovulation, pregnancy, and other reproductive functions. Let's look at the hypothalamus, pituitary, gonadal axis. The hypothalamus, the pituitary gland, and ovaries form the hypothalamus, pituitary, gonadal axis, HPG. The hypothalamus releases gonadotropin releasing hormone, which stimulates the pituitary gland. Let's look at the follicle-stimulating hormones. Follicle-stimulating hormone is released by the pituitary gland under the influence of gonadotropin-releasing hormone. The follicle-stimulating hormone stimulates the growth and development of the ovarian follicles in the ovaries. Let's look at luteinizing hormone. Luteinizing hormone is released by the pituitary gland in response to gonadotropin releasing hormone. The luteinizing hormone stage triggers ovulation and the release of a mature egg or ova from the ovary. Let's look at estrogen. Estrogen is primarily produced by the developing ovarian follicles. Estrogen plays a key role in the development and maintenance of the female reproductive organs. The various female reproductive organs that we learned about in the previous slides, they are maintained with the help of estrogen. Secondary sexual characteristics and also regulation of the menstrual cycle, all these are under the control of estrogen. Let's look at progesterone. Progesterone is produced by the corpus luteum, which forms in the ovary after ovulation. Progesterone prepares the uterus for implantation and also helps to maintain pregnancy if fertilization occurs. Let's look at feedback mechanisms. The female reproductive hormones are regulated by intricate feedback mechanisms. One of it is a negative feedback mechanism, whereby the rising levels of estrogen and progesterone will inhibit the release of gonadotropin releasing hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, and luteinizing hormone. Let's look at the positive feedback. A seed in estrogen triggers a positive feedback loop, leading to the luteinizing hormone seed and also ovulation. That is the release of the ova or egg. Let's look at the menstrual cycle phases and hormonal regulation. The menstrual cycle is a complex process that is regulated by hormones that occur in women of reproductive age. Hormonal fluctuations during menstrual cycle derive the growth and shedding of the uterine lining. The menstrual cycle is controlled by the hypothalamic ovarian axis. The hypothalamus releases gonadotropin releasing hormone, which stimulates the pituitary gland. Let's look at the follicular phase. The follicular phase begins when the menstrual begins with the menstrual period and extends until ovulation. The hypothalamus releases gonadotropin releasing hormone, which stimulates the pituitary gland to start producing follicle-stimulating hormone. Let's look at follicle development and estrogen. Follicle-stimulating hormone promotes the growth and development of the ovarian follicles. The developing ovarian follicles are the ones that are responsible for the production of estrogen, of which when estrogen is produced, it makes the lining of the uterus become very thick, plenty of blood supply, and this prepares the uterus for potential implantation of the fertilized ova. Let's look at ovulation. A seed or a rise in or a sharp rise in luteinizing hormone triggers ovulation. Luteinizing hormone is released by the pituitary gland under the influence of follicle, under the influence of gonadotropin releasing hormone. Let's look at ovulation. The luteal phase. The luteal phase begins after ovulation and lasts until the start of the next menstrual period. After ovulation, the ruptured follicle forms the corpus luteum, which also produces progesterone. Remember, we said that the work of progesterone was to maintain the pregnancy in case fertilization took place. Progesterone and uterine changes. Progesterone prepares the uterus for implantation and also supports the early pregnancy. It also promotes the development of rich blood supply in the lining of the uterus in case fertilization took place. Hormonal feedback mechanisms, negative feedback. The rising levels of estrogen and progesterone inhibit the release of gonadotropin releasing hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, and luteinizing hormone. Positive feedback. Here, the high levels of estrogen trigger a seed in luteinizing hormone, and this will lead to ovulation. Let's look at menstruation. If fertilization does not occur, the corpus luteum regresses, leading to a decline in estrogen and progesterone levels. So, the shedding of the uterine lining occurs, resulting into menstrual bleeding. But otherwise, if fertilization occurred, then the uterine lining is maintained. There will also be no shedding of what? Menstrual blood, because fertilization has occurred and the endometrium continues to maintain its thickness such that it can be able to take care of the fertilized ovum. But if fertilization did not occur, then it means that the shedding of the uterine lining occurs, which will result into menstrual bleeding. Other people put it that the uterus is crying for the lost child. Pregnancy and hormonal changes. Hormonal changes during pregnancy including the role of human chorionic gonadotropin, HCG, in maintaining the corpus luteum and also supporting the early pregnancy. So the placenta takes over the production of hormones to support the pregnancy, that is, as the pregnancy continues growing. Below, you have an image of the pregnancy and hormonal changes. So, up on top of the image, you have the follicular phase, you have the luteal phase, you can see menstruation occurring, that is 0 to 4 days. So when the menstruation is occurring, it means that the follicle stimulating hormones or the hormonal levels are low, and also after menstruation, the hormonal levels will start rising, and also the ovarian follicles will also start to grow. Then by around the 14th day, that is if it is a 28-day cycle, there will be a seed in luteinizing hormone. You can see the rise in the curve of luteinizing hormone. So that seed of luteinizing hormone will lead to ovulation on the 14th day, that is if at all the individual is having a cycle of 28 days. Then after ovulation, you can see there is a thickening of the endometrium. The endometrium has become very thick. There is a lot of blood supply. Then the luteal phase sets in. Here, progesterone is also now being secreted by the corpus luteum. In case fertilization takes place, then it means that the uterine lining will continue to be thick. It will thicken, it will continue to be thick, preparing for the embedment of the fertilized ovum, that is in case fertilization took place. But if fertilization does not take place by the 28th day, then it means that menstruation is starting again. So when menstruation starts again, it means that there will be loss of the menstrual blood flow, and also the unfertilized egg or ova will be lost in the blood. Let's look at menarche. Menarche is the onset of the first menstrual period in girls, and it marks the beginning of the reproductive maturity. In some other tribes, they honor the day when the girl sees her first menstrual period. In other words, in fact, they will even prepare for a party because they know that now their girl is mature enough and ready to get married. Anyway, menarche is a significant milestone in the girl's life, and it is associated with physical and emotional changes. Timing of menarche. Menarche typically occurs between the ages of 9 and 16 years, but on average, it varies across the individual and also populations. Various factors influence the timing of menarche. These include the genetics, nutrition, and environmental factors. Let's look at pubertal changes. Remember, we said menarche is part of the broader pubertal development that includes other physical changes. Some of these physical changes include breast development, growth sprouts. The girl will grow very fast. The body will become hairy, or the body will develop hair under the armpits, hair in the reproductive part. Hormonal changes are common during puberty. Let's look at hormonal changes during menarche. Menarche is initiated by homonogeneous, particularly the activity of the hypopituitary gonadal axis. The hypopituitary the hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis, that is HPG axis, leads to the maturation of the ovaries and production of estrogen and progesterone. Let's look at emotional and psychological aspects. Menarche can bring about a range of emotions and psychological experiences. Some of the girls will feel excited, some of the girls will become confused, anxiety, and others will become very proud because now they have reached womanhood. Menstrual education and support. Menarche is the time period whereby it is important for the parents to teach the girl about menstrual education and also support. Girls should be given accurate information about menstruation, hygiene practices, and menstrual product options, and also the girls should be warned that since they have started menstruating, if they go about having sexual intercourse with boys, especially on the 14th day, if it is a girl and the girl is having a cycle of 28 days, chances are that she is most likely to conceive. So it is important that she takes good care of herself by not indulging into sexual intercourse. In summary, we have looked at the anatomy and physiology of the female reproductive system, where we saw the different parts of the female reproductive system and their functions. We also looked at the menstrual cycle and menstrual education to support the girl. Then we also looked at menarche and also the emotional and psychological changes that take place during menarche. Thank you for listening and have a blessed day.